Was this latest hurricane caused by global warming or not? These days, it seems like there's no shortage of devastating weather events unfolding around the entire world. In late August 2017, at the same time that Houston was underwater from Hurricane Harvey, so too was nearly half the country of Bangladesh. That's right, nearly half the country. And these disasters were quickly followed by record-breaking floods in Nigeria, then Hurricane Irma the very next week. Whenever an extreme weather event happens, whether it's a record-breaking hurricane, or a flood, or a drought, or a wildfire, or a heat wave, one of the first questions everyone wants to know is, did global warming make this happen? There's never a shortage of people ready to say, yes, it did. But there are just as many people, maybe more, who poo-poo any mention of climate change in connection with a disaster. So where's the truth? It turns out, it's right in the middle. Climate change interacts with and exacerbates natural weather and climate hazards. In the same way that changes in our body's condition, being tired and run down or having poor diet and exercise habits, can make us more vulnerable to disease and illness, changes that we've made to our planet by adding heat-trapping gases to the atmosphere can amplify the risks we face from many types of natural weather extremes, including heat waves, heavy precipitation events, droughts, and yes, even tropical storms like Hurricanes Harvey and Irma. There's no question that when terrible flooding or other disasters happen, our first priority should be on making sure we are doing everything we can to help those who are immediately affected. Lecturing someone on climate change when their house is underwater and everything they've owned has just been swept away is like preaching to somebody about their hamburger consumption when they're in an ambulance on the way to a hospital after a heart attack. But for everyone else, the time when natural disasters happen is actually absolutely the right time to be talking about climate change. Why? Because as humans, we are all too good at pretending that a risk, even when we know is real, doesn't matter. We eat whatever we feel like, we don't exercise nearly as much as we know we should, and we always think that heart attack is going to happen to someone else. Climate change is the same way. The most dangerous myth we've bought into isn't that climate change isn't real or that humans aren't responsible. It's that it will only harm plants and animals, future generations, someone else, not me. The reality is that we care about climate change because it affects everyone on this planet, including me and the people I know and love. And one of the biggest ways it does, though, is through global weirding. That's right, taking the normal weather and climate conditions, the averages and the extremes that we're used to in the places where we live, and amping them up. So how exactly does climate change affect the risks associated with hurricanes? If you asked 100 climate scientists, nearly all of them would agree that a given hurricane did not occur because of climate change, but it was very likely exacerbated by it in a few different ways. First, in a warmer world, there's more water vapor available for storms to sweep up and dump on us. And hurricanes are very big storms. We've already seen increases in heavy precipitation around the world as the planet has warmed. And in fact, this is one of the symptoms that has been definitively fingerprinted or attributed to human-induced change. While it's not yet possible to determine exactly how much rainfall from a given hurricane was due to climate change, nearly every scientific study agrees that as the world warms, the amount of rainfall associated with hurricanes will increase on average. Second, as the world warms, the seas are rising as land-based ice melts and warm ocean water expands. This increases the risks associated with storm surges. With more water behind them, they can be more powerful. And with higher sea level, more coastal areas are flooded during a given storm on average than would have been 50 or 100 years ago. And then we have the third factor, the fact that hurricanes get their energy from warm ocean water. And over 90% of the excess heat being trapped inside the climate system from the buildup of heat-trapping gases in the atmosphere is going where? Into the ocean. There are other factors in play, but all else being equal, warmer oceans will increase the energy available to hurricanes to rapidly intensify as they pass over areas with unusually warm water. That's why it's likely that we could see more intense hurricanes in the future. So, how will the number of hurricanes and other tropical cyclones change? This is the toughest question, because hurricane formation is affected by a lot of different factors. What we know right now suggests that we aren't likely to see increases in the total number of hurricanes in the future. And in fact, we may even see a few less. But the storms that we do see will most likely be fiercer ones. Here's the bottom line. Climate change doesn't cause most hurricanes or floods or even wildfires, but it does make them stronger and more devastating. So if we only use our experience with past disasters to inform future preparation, we run the risk of dangerously underestimating the amount of area that might be burnt, coastal flooding, rainfall, even the average strength of the hurricanes that do come our way. Our civilization is built on an obsolete assumption, one that's becoming increasingly dangerous, that our climate is stable, that the 500-year flood event can be accurately predicted from what's happened in the past, that if the area where I live has never been burned by wildfire before, it never will be, or that the drought of record is the worst it will ever get. In a changing climate, these assumptions are outdated. Houston? They've had 3 500-year floods in as many years. California? Sure, there have been droughts before, but the drought they experienced from 2012 to 2017 was stronger and lasted longer thanks to the record-breaking heat that reinforced and maintained an unusually strong ridge of high pressure over the region during the drought. So, what can we do to counteract this out-of-date assumption? It just makes sense to build resilience to the risks that we already face today and make sure at the same time we're preparing for even greater extremes that we might face in the future. Like Jason, who left this message on my Facebook page the week after Hurricane Harvey hit Houston. He said, "Dear Catherine, a while back you posted about the changing frequency of rare weather events like 500-year floods. I read it carefully. And then last year when we were buying a house in Houston, I checked the floodplain estimate and I made sure we were well beyond 500 years. Thanks to your timely post, our place is totally dry and we barely have a puddle on our street. Listening to climate science translated through you has paid off. Thanks. All of us, and that includes our cities, our states, and our governments too, we need to think more like Jason. To protect ourselves from weather and climate disasters, we need to build our resilience to the risks of the future, not just the past." Thank you for watching Global Weirding. Be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com every other Wednesday for a new episode. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. Have a question about climate change? We want to hear it. We'll have a live Q&A on our Facebook page every other Thursday at 7 p.m. Central. See you next time.